Yes, screen visible, students. Screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Right. In the last class, I discussed that the force between the two conductors carrying current I1 and I2, and they are separated by a distance small d. It is given by F is equal to mu into I1 I2 L divided by 2 pi d. F is equal to mu into I1 I2 into L, where L is the length of each of the conductors, that divided by 2 pi d. Based on this formula, we will solve few examples. Note down this example. Find the force per meter length between two long parallel wires separated by 10 cm in air and carrying current of 100 ampere in opposite directions. State the nature of the force between the wires. Find the force per meter length between two long parallel wires separated by 10 cm in air and carrying current of 100 ampere in opposite directions. State the nature of force between the wires.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, allow Ankita.
Okay. I have admitted her. Taken. Note down the question, we'll solve it. Taken. We'll start solving. Read the question. Find the force per meter length. They have asked to calculate the value of force per meter length between two long parallel wires. There are two long parallel wires. They are separated by 10 cm in air. They are separated by a distance of 10 cm and each carry current of 100 ampere. Each is carrying a current of 100 ampere in the opposite directions. Right? That means if one is carrying the current from bottom to top, another one is carrying the current from top to bottom. State the nature of the force between the wires. Now for air medium, we know that mu is equal to mu naught into mu r. For air medium, mu is mu naught into mu r, that is mu r is 1. For air, relative permeability is 1. Therefore, it will be simply equal to mu naught, that is absolute permeability. The value of absolute permeability is 4.2 10 to minus 7 Henry per meter. Okay, this is the value of mu naught. Then D is the distance of separation. How much is the small d value? They have mentioned in the question. Separated by 10 centimeter. That means the distance of separation is 10 centimeter. This 10 into 10 raised to minus 2 meter. 1 centimeter is equal to 10 raised to minus 2 meters. Right? So 100 centimeter makes 1 meter. So 1 centimeter will be equal to 1 by 100. That is 10 raised to minus 2 meters. Then I1 is equal to I2 is equal to I. That is current. Current value is given. That is 100 ampere. Value of current is 100 ampere. In general, the force between two parallel long wires is given by the force between the two parallel long wires, each of length L and with the distance D separated. It is given by F is equal to mu I1 I2 L divided by 2 pi D. F is equal to mu I1 I2 L divided by 2 pi D. That is force per meter length. If you want force per meter length, then we have to take this L to the LHS. So what we will get, Fi by L, that is equal to mu is simply mu naught into I1 into I2 divided by 2 pi D. Okay, take this formula and calculate and tell me what is the value of F by L, that is force per unit length. Tell me the value. How much is the value, students? F by L. How much you are getting? What is the value? How much are getting F by L? Anybody calculated? Janvi, what is the value? Abhishek? Abhishek? How much you are getting value of F by L? Sir. Yes?
0.2.
Answer?
0.02.
Correct. The answer is 0.02 Newton per meter. Okay. This is the value of force per unit length. Right. That is, we have to calculate F by L. If they are asking force per unit length, we have to calculate F divided by L. That will give us force per unit length. That is for L equal to 1 meters. Unit length means L equal to 1 meter. Now, the next part of the question, what they have asked is state the nature of the force between wires. State the nature of the force between the wires. Here, can you make a judgment as to whether it is the attractive force or the repulsive force? whether the force between the two conductors here, what is being mentioned, whether it is repulsive force or attractive force.
Repulsive force, sir.
Yes, repulsive force. How it is repulsive force? Can you justify your answer? How it will be repulsive? Why not attractive? While explaining about the concept of the force between two conductors, right, we have considered that if the direction of the force is from bottom to top in both of the conductors, that diagram, try to recollect what I had explained in yesterday's class, this diagram. Here the current is flowing from bottom to top, here also it is flowing from bottom to top, okay. So here the force is attractive force between the two differential current elements, correct? Because here if we are considering a node, it is flowing in this direction. If it is a node here, then it is flowing in the other direction. So it is a attractive force between the two current elements if both are flowing in the same direction. Now here both are flowing in the opposite direction. Look at the question. State the nature of forces. They are flowing in the opposite direction. Each are carrying a current of 100 ampere in the opposite directions. That means one will be from bottom to top, another current will be from top to bottom. Hence the nature of force will be repulsive in nature. Okay, whatever you answered is correct. So the nature of force will be repulsive because one current is from one direction, from bottom to top, another one is in the opposite direction from top to bottom. Hence the nature of force is repulsive. Okay. Any difficulty in this example? Hope it is clear to everyone. This example. Okay, we'll move to the next example. Find the force per meter length between two long parallel wires separated by 10 centimeter in air carrying a current of 10 ampere in the same direction. Find the force per meter length between, note down the question, find the force per meter length between two long parallel wires separated by 10 centimeter in air and carrying a current of 10 ampere in the same direction. Just solve it on your own and tell me the final answer.
Thank you.
Anybody solved it? Ankita? Have you solved it, Ankita? Okay. Anybody got the answer?
(0.2)(10⁻³).
Okay, let us check. Very good. 0.2 × 10⁻³ newton per meter. Force unit is newton. Then unit of length is meter. It is 0.2 × 10⁻³ newton per meter. Okay, force per unit length. Let us see that example. That is, force between two parallel conductors is given by the same formula. F is equal to mu into I1 I2 L divided by 2 pi d. For free space, mu is mu naught into mu r. That is, mu naught it will be equal to mu naught into mu r, but mu r is 1, so it is simply equal to mu naught. It is 4.2 × 10⁻⁷ Henry per meter. Then distance d is 10 centimeter, that is 10 × 10⁻² meters. I1 equal to I2, they have given it as 10 ampere. Hence, force per unit length is given by F by L. Take this L to the LHS, it will come to the denominator. It will be F by L is equal to the value of mu is mu naught, that is 4.2 × 10⁻⁷. I1, I2 both are 10 ampere into 10 into 10, right? That divided by 2 pi into d. The value of d is 10 × 10⁻² meters. The answer comes out to 0.2 × 10⁻³ newton per meter. That is 0.2 millinewton per meter. Right? Is it clear this example, students, to everyone? Any difficulty in these two examples? Any difficulty in these two examples? Okay, we'll proceed further. I hope everyone have understood. Janvi, is it understood?
Yes, sir, understood.
Okay. Take the third example. Two infinitely long straight conductors are located at x equal to 0, y equal to 0, and x equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. Both carry current of 10 ampere in positive az bar direction. Determine force experienced per meter between them. I'll repeat. Two infinitely long straight conductors are located at x equal to 0, y equal to 0, and x equal to 0, y equal to 10 meter. Both carry current of 10 ampere in positive z bar direction. Determine force experienced per meter between them. Note down the question. We'll solve it.
Thank you.
Okay, noted down the question. Read the question. Two infinitely long straight conductors are located at x equal to 0, y equal to 0. First, you have to place one of the conductors at x equal to 0, y equal to 0. What is the meaning of x equal to y equal to 0? Anyone? What is the meaning of x equal to 0, y equal to 0? What is meant by at the coordinates x equal to 0, y equal to 0? Yes, please. It means it is along which axis? It is along the z axis. It is along the z axis. X is 0, y is 0, both are 0. It is along the z axis. Yes or no? That is one of the conductors. Then at x equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. X equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. So it is on which axis? X equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. X is 0. So where is x 0 on y axis? X equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. On at a distance of 10 meters on y axis, there is another conductor. Both these two conductors are parallel. Both these two conductors are in parallel. Okay. Both carry current of 10 ampere in positive AZ bar direction. They are carrying the current in the positive AZ bar direction. Okay. Tell me the answer. How much?
2 micronewton per meter.
2 micronewton per meter. Very good. Your answer is correct. 2 micronewton per meter. Others are getting the same answer. What about others? Are you getting the same answer, students? Sheeraj, how much is the answer you are getting, Sheeraj? Sheeraj, doing it. Okay, solve it. Karthik, you got the answer? Karthik? Tejas? Tejas?
Sir, already said.
Okay, fine. Janvi? Janvi? You are getting the answer?
Yes, sir.
How much you are getting?
2
unit is? Whether it is nano newton or micro or pico, what it is?
Micro.
Micro newton. Fine. Okay. Deepa? Deepa?
Yes, sir.
How much you are getting? Answer.
2 micronewtons, sir.
Correct. Okay. Ankita?
Yes, sir. Same.
Same answer?
Same answer.
Okay. Vishal Vasulkar? Vishal? Why he left the meeting? Okay. Ruthik? Ruthik, have you solved the example? Ruthik? What is the answer? Ruthik? Okay, we'll solve that quickly. So mu is equal to mu naught into mu r, that is mu naught into 1, that will be equal to mu naught, that is 4.2 10 to minus 7 Henry per meter. This is a standard value, that is absolute permeability. Assuming parallel conductors are in air medium. Okay, assuming that these two conductors are in air medium. Two conductors are separated by distance of d is equal to 10 meters. They are separated by a distance of 10 meters, these two conductors. Then force between two infinitely long straight conductors is given by, they are infinitely long straight conductors, right? The force between these two infinitely long straight conductors, even if they are infinitely long straight conductors, we are supposed to find out force per unit length. Okay, that is, they are not given the length. Suppose if they give the length, then what you are supposed to do, you have to multiply with the L, that is length, whatever they are giving, and then you have to find the value of force. Now what they are asking is force per unit length, that is F by L they are asking. That means you have to rearrange the terms here, that L you have to bring it to the LHS, it will be F by L, and you will get F by L is equal to mu naught into I1 into I2 divided by 2 pi d. So that will be equal to mu naught is 4.2 10 to minus 7, I1, I2 both are 10 into 10 into 10, that divided by 2 pi into d. D is how much they have given? What is the value of d? D is 10 meters. Yes, the value of d, distance between the two conductors, it is 10 meters. How it is 10 meters? Who will tell me? How it is 10 meters? How the distance between the two conductors is 10 meters. Have they mentioned anywhere in the question that it is d is equal to 10 meters? Yes, please. How the value of d is 10 meters? Look here. Here they have mentioned two infinitely long straight conductors are located at x equal to 0, y equal to 0, and x equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. X equal to 0, y equal to 0, that is at the origin, they are placed on the z axis, right? Then next is x equal to 0, y equal to 10 meters. Y equal to 10 meters means it is on this axis, y axis, positive y axis, correct? X is 0 on y axis, okay? They have placed another conductor, right? Therefore, the distance between the two conductors is 10 meters. Distance between the two conductors is 10 meters. You have to consider this as the distance between the two conductors. If we consider this 10 meters and substitute, we will get the value of F by L as 2 micronewton, 2 micronewton per meter it is. Just note down here, it is 2 micronewton per meter. The M is missing. That is 2 micronewton per meter. Okay. Any difficulty in these examples, friends? Is it clear to everyone? These examples? So basically they have given this x and y value, right? Even though we are not using these coordinates, they have mentioned this coordinate. One thing is to find the distance, right? Just to give the distance, they are mentioning the coordinates, right? There is nothing to do with the coordinates here. X is equal to 0, y equal to 0. We have nothing to do with the coordinates, but we are getting the value of the distance between the coordinates as y equal to 10 meters. Okay. So in that way, the formula, everything remains the same, and the final value, whatever we are getting is 2 into 10 to minus 6 newton per meters. Next is magnetic torque. What is meant by torque, students? You have heard of torque. You have heard of torque. You have come across this word torque in your UC level. How do you define torque? Or what is a torque? It is the product of force into distance. Is it not? Product of force into distance is the torque. Similarly here, the moment of a force or a torque, it is nothing but the product of the arm distance r and the force f. That is, the distance r and the force f, product of these two will give us the moment of a force or the torque. Okay, the unit of this torque is, it is a product of force and the distance, so it is newton meter. The unit of magnetic torque or the torque is newton meter. This torque is the product of r into f. Then what is r, what is f? Let us look into the figure here. This is our r, the distance from origin to the point where the force is applied. The force f is applied in this direction, right, at the point A. The distance from the origin to this point A, that is our r vector. If we take the product of r and f, that will give us the torque. And the direction of this torque is perpendicular. It is perpendicular to the plane containing the two vectors r and f vector. It is contained in the xy plane here. The perpendicular to xy plane is in the z direction. Hence, the direction of the torque is in the z direction if the given two vectors, that is r and f vector, are in the xy plane. Clear here? The torque is given by product of r and f, and its direction is given by the direction in which it is the perpendicular between the, for the given plane in which the two vectors r and f exist. If r and f are in xy plane, then the direction will be in the z plane. Okay, that is in the az bar direction. Consider a point A at which force F is applied as shown in the figure. Let R be the arm from origin O to point A. Let R be the distance or the arm from origin O to point A. Then torque T about origin is a vector product of R and F. The torque T is a vector product of R and F. Direction of the torque is normal to the plane containing both R and F. Direction of the torque is perpendicular to the vector containing or to the plane containing R and F vectors. Now consider that there are two forces F1 and F2. Instead of a single force, consider two forces F1 and F2. They are applied at points A1 and A2 respectively. There are two forces F1 and F2. As you can see in this figure, they are applied. One is at point A1, another one is applied at point A2. Right? The distance from origin to the point A1 is R1. The distance of from the origin to the point A2 is R2. So we have R1 vector and R2 vectors. Okay. Then what will be the total torque? We know that the torque is in the perpendicular direction or in the resultant direction for the both the forces F1 and F2. But what is the magnitude of the total torque? That we have to find out. As you can see in this figure, F1 is in this direction and F2 is in the opposite direction. So what is the relation between F2 and F1? The relation between F2 and F1 is F2 is equal to minus of F1. F2 is equal to minus of F1. Okay. Hence, arm of the two forces drawn from origin B R1 and R2 respectively, assume that F2 is equal to minus F1. Then the total torque T about the origin due to the forces is given by T is equal to, for the force F1, it is given by R1 into F1. Then the for the force F2, it is given by R2 into F2. Okay. So the total value of torque will be R1 F1 plus R2 F2. Yes. Total value of torque will be R1 into F1 plus R2 into F2. But we know that F2 is equal to minus F1. We assumed that F2 is equal to minus of F1. Both are in the opposite directions. Hence, it will be R1 F1 minus R2 F1. That is, if we take F1 common, we get T is equal to, or torque is equal to R1 minus R2 into F1 vector. That is, T is equal to R21 into F1, where R21 is R1 minus R2. 2 is the source and 1 is the destination. So it is from, sorry, So it is from R1 minus R2. Two is the source, one is the destination. Destination minus source. How you are taking the vectors? Vectors difference or the subtraction of two vectors. Destination minus source. That is R1 minus R2 is a vector joining E2 to E1. Next is the magnetic dipole moment. Any doubts up till here, students? Is it clear? This magnetic torque is clear. Topic on magnetic torque is clear. Yes. Is it understood, students? Magnetic torque here. Ankita. Ankita.
Yes, sir.
Understood.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next is the magnetic dipole moment. Magnetic dipole moment is defined as the product of the current through the loop and the area of the loop. If we take the product of the current and the area of the loop, that will give us the magnetic dipole moment M. Right? It is defined as the product of the current through the loop and the area of the loop, that is S, and its direction is along the direction of the thumb, according to the right hand thumb rule. If we take the direction of the fingers, the curl of the fingers as the direction of the current, then the direction of the thumb will give us the direction of the magnetic dipole moment. Okay, it is along the direction of the unit vector, that is the direction of the magnetic dipole moment will be always along the direction of the right hand thumb. It is a vector quantity because it has a particular direction. It is a vector quantity. Direction of the magnetic dipole moment is given by the right hand thumb rule. The right hand thumb indicates the direction of the unit vector in which M is directed, and fingers represent the current direction. Okay, the right hand thumb indicates direction of the unit vector in which M is directed, and the fingers represent the current direction. Next, we'll move on to magnetic materials and magnetism. All these are the fundamental topics you might have studied in your PU level. Magnetic materials and magnetism. The first one is nature of magnetic materials. We know that an electron, it has its own spin. It spins in its own orbit, right? As an electron is a charged particle, the spin of the electron, it produces some magnetic moment, and that we call it as magnetic dipole moment. The magnetic moment produced due to the spin of electrons is called as magnetic dipole moment. Similar to the electron spin, there is a nuclear spin, the spin of the nucleus, right, which will contribute to a magnetic moment, and it is called as nuclear spin magnetic moment. The spin of the electrons produces magnetic dipole moment. The spin of the nucleus produces nuclear spin magnetic moment. Remember these two points. Okay. Then what is the classification of magnetic materials? How the magnetic materials are classified? The magnetic materials are classified as diamagnetic, paramagnetic and ferromagnetic materials. Okay. These three are the main classification of the magnetic materials. Diamagnetic material, paramagnetic material and ferromagnetic materials. Then when we say that a material is magnetic and when it is non-magnetic. When is the material magnetic and when it is non-magnetic? Magnetic materials can be classified based on the relative permeability mu r. Based on this relative permeability mu r, we are able to classify the materials as magnetic and non-magnetic. Material is said to be non-magnetic if value of mu r is less than 1 or approximately equal to 1. If the value of relative permeability is less than 1 or approximately equal to 1, then it is said to be non-magnetic material. If the relative permeability mu r is greater than or equal to 1, then it is said to be magnetic material. Okay. If the mu r value is less than 1 or approximately equal to 1, then it is non-magnetic. If the value of mu r is greater than 1 or approximately equal to 1, then it is magnetic in nature. If a value of mu r is slightly less than unity, then it is called as diamagnetic material. If value of relative permeability is slightly less than 1, then it is diamagnetic material. If value of mu r is slightly greater than 1, then it is paramagnetic material. If value of mu r is very large than 1, it is very larger than unity, then it is said to be ferromagnetic material. So we have three types here. One is diamagnetic, in which the mu r is less than unity, paramagnetic, in which mu r is slightly greater than unity, and ferromagnetic, in which the mu r is very larger than unity. The materials in which the dipole moment of adjacent atoms they are in a anti-parallel order, right? If the adjacent atoms in a material, they are aligned in anti-parallel fashion, in which the dipole moment of adjacent atoms, they lie in anti-parallel fashion, such of the materials are called anti-ferromagnetic materials. That is, if the magnetic dipole moments are aligned in anti-parallel fashion, that is anti-parallel fashion, then they are called as anti-ferromagnetic materials. The net magnetic moment in these anti-ferromagnetic materials is zero. This is an important point. The net magnetic moment in the anti-ferromagnetic materials is always same. Then the materials in which the magnetic dipole moments are lined up in the anti-parallel fashion. In some materials, the magnetic dipole moments, right, of the material are aligned in anti-parallel fashion, but the net magnetic moment is not zero. The net magnetic moment is non-zero. Such of the materials are called ferrimagnetic materials. Note the difference between ferromagnetic and ferrimagnetic. Right? In ferromagnetic materials, what is the property? In anti-ferromagnetic materials, they are aligned in anti-parallel fashion, that is the dipole moments, but the net magnetic moment is zero in the anti-ferromagnetic materials. Whereas in the ferrimagnetic materials, the dipole moments are in anti-parallel fashion, but the net magnetic moment is non-zero. Okay, so these are few of the classifications of the magnetic materials, right? Hence, in today's class, we have covered three examples. We have taken up three examples on the force between two parallel long wires or two parallel conductors. And after solving these three examples, we have covered a topic on magnetic torque. What is magnetic torque? Its definition, its formula, right? And if there are more than two forces, what is the resultant magnetic torque? That formula we have written, the equation. Then what is magnetic dipole moment? What is magnetic dipole moment? Its formula. Then its direction is given by the right hand thumb rule. Magnetic materials and magnetism, nature of magnetic materials. That is, one is the spin of electron produces magnetic dipole moment. The spin of nucleus produces nuclear spin magnetic moment. And classification of magnetic materials are diamagnetic, paramagnetic, and ferromagnetic materials. Basic classification. If mu r is less than 1, they are non-magnetic. If mu r is greater than 1, it is magnetic in nature. Again, further classification is if mu r is slightly less than 1, it is diamagnetic. If mu r is slightly greater than 1, it is paramagnetic. If mu r is very larger than 1, it is ferromagnetic in nature. Then, if the dipole moments are in anti-parallel fashion, but their net magnetic moment is zero, such of the materials are called anti-ferromagnetic materials. But if the material has magnetic dipole moments in the anti-parallel fashion, but the net magnetic moment is non-zero, then they are called as ferrimagnetic materials. Okay. Any difficulty in today's class, students? Any difficulty here? Janvi, any difficulty? Yes, any difficulty, Janvi?
No, sir, no difficulty.
Okay. Karthik? Karthik? Karthik Patil? Shiraj? Shiraj? Understood, Shiraj?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Shiraj? Okay, right. Tejas?
Yes, sir, understood, sir.
Okay. Ankita? Ankita?
Yes, sir.
Right. Ilyas Ahmad? Ilyas,
yes,
Ahmad?
Yes. Understood.
Understood the concepts, Ilyas Ahmad?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay. Right. Ruthik? Ruthik Chopra?
Yes, sir, understood, sir.
Okay. So, in the next class, we will continue with the next topics in the, that is, second half of module 4. We are into the second half of module 4. That is, we have started with the magnetic materials. Okay. Later on, we'll be looking into the other part, that is boundary conditions in the electromagnetic fields, and then we'll take up the inductance and mutual inductance. Okay. Those things we'll cover in the next class. Thank you.